then shift that table back a bit.
That's alright, it's a hippie. So if we move the lamp, you're okay?
Yeah, just, I think...
Listen, you can shift the table back a bit so you can zoom further.
We should be good, Bob.
You happy?
Yeah, I'm reasonably happy with those two. It's kind of going up a bit.
The closer, yeah, the less the depth of focus.
And you can keep a close eye on it.
Paul, just give me out to any little return there, and give me sort of half volume.
I like the way it's favouring the left side, and that's. I'm just positioning out my frame, Bob, to make sure I've got you guys in exactly where I want you to make you look nice.
So excuse me, Margaret, I'm just going to move this.
Yeah.
All of it. Sorry, Bob.
It's very nice on the
meat. 5 pin return's got a bit of whistle on it.
That's what I do, get that a little bit across there.
Have a look.
Oh, that's good.
Can you reach the dimmer on that?
Thank you.
And just wind it up a touch, please.
We're at the full.
Very nice.
Look, and you have it left.
Is that,
just depends on what outside.
Is that plugged in, that lamp?
No.
It's not. Does it have a lamp in it that works?
No, it's not working.
I think it could be.
Could you stick it up?
No. Oh, yes, it can be. It can be. I didn't know there was this plug on it.
Margaret, may I use your toilet before we start?
Sure.
I'm the nervous one.
That way. That way and on the right.
Thank you.
I can plug that in down there. Is there a bulb in it?
Yes.
Okay, great. This is going to look really nice.
This is a PowerPoint here.
Yeah, be careful with that, Bob. It'll just give us a nice bit of warmth, you see, because it's natural. It's your sort of your classic domestic.
But it's a fluorescent.
Oh, I see. That's all right.
Fluorescent is not as good. Eh?
No, it's different. It's very different. It's not quite as warm, but that's all right.
I can put an ordinary red.
No, that's good, Bob. That's looking good.
Margaret, just I can see your cable just here. If you can see on your right hand side, just on the other side there. Okay. Yeah. Thank you. Excellent. Thank you.
Very interesting. I'm as much interested in you than you are in doing this.
I see that.
I'll give a close up of the camera. What sort of camera is it? A Sony?
Yep. Sure is.
It's huge.
Sony. You can rely on Sony. Although, I can show you. Still camera, I can't get memory stick for and I can't get batteries for it.
Oh, really?
And so that has cost me $2,700.
Oh.
And I can't use it. I only use it now for doing
color slides. And you only just color slides.
It's a still camera, it's not a movie camera.
Cool. And you like this as good, isn't it?
Are those the wires transmitters?
They're receiving what the transmitter that I put on you, too. Yeah. So I've got, and the diversity.
Shall I give you a little? Tell me what you think.
It receives two signals from you.
Just a tad. Yep. Down
there.
Does that balance up with the symmetrical?
Yep. You have a fiddle with that. What I might do, this sun is coming and going. May I just draw this curtain closed a little bit?
Are we done? On the side of the curtain is a batten.
Yes.
And you use the batten pushing the curtain when it's much easier. Yeah.
Brilliant. Now, sorry guys, excuse me again, I'm just going to move this cable back.
Yeah, of course. Look underneath.
Oh, very nice. Very nice. That's good. Excellent, thank you. We're nearly there, guys. Almost ready to go.
You've done well.
Right, Ben.
Yeah.
So, are you comfortable with all this stuff?
Oh, yeah. I trust if you've always done it.
Now, if you want to stop at any time...
Yeah.
Just let us know. Just stop.
Oh, yeah.
If you need to think about something, or...
Well, I'll give you...
Just say stop.
You don't see that today.
Just say stop. We can stop.
find this easy, Bob.
You know all about it.
I shaved myself because I know they can see you risk us.
Yeah. You're looking good.
Well, I wish I could look younger, actually.
Yeah.
Shall we roll?
Distinguished.
Yeah, rock and roll.
You're good?
I'm good, thank you very much. This is my, just a phone, cell phone check.
Oh, good call.
Now, when I answer,
is that your wife? Is that fully white or can you come start
white?
You
can go white.
Alright, so we've got an option. That's a lovely
Lee, sorry, this is the hard part, but even though we're all in the room, Lee's the only man that you talk to.
I know, so you talk to me.
But the TV will see me speaking, but who do I speak to?
You speak to me.
Oh, but I look at you.
You look at me.
That's what I mean.
Exactly like this. We'll all
so
the talking.
So I'm not looking at the camera, I look at you.
You always look at me. We don't look at the camera.
That's right.
And that will be the rule for the whole day.
Uh-huh.
So yes. Even when we're outside and I'm in different positions, you just find me and talk to me.
Only when I want to talk to the outside world, I look at the camera.
If you want to, then you have a go at that. For this interview, it's just going to be you and I, Bob, you and I, Margaret.
And how does it look that I look to you?
Looks good. Looks good. Okay. Oh, that's great. I like having that as an option.
I really like that.
Absolutely.
Before I get stuck with this advancing light,
can you go, Jimmy?
Just want to walk this in a little bit. I've got some.
You can move that away, you know.
No, that's fine.
It's fine,
okay at the moment, thanks, Bob. Okay. Thank you very much. We're just trying to provide. Is it still going to work for you?
Yeah, I'll get in there.
That light is easy on the eyes.
Good.
Okay.
It's not too bright. Oh, you can
totally dim it.
Yeah. I didn't know you could dim fluorescence.
That's why you pay $3,500 for the light.
Great device.
I can dim those lights on the ground there, but not much.
That's right. That's good. That helped. So I think unless anybody has anything else,
I'm very excited and ready to roll. Are you guys comfortable and happy?
Yep.
Yeah.
Good.
Okay.
So basically, this is just like a conversation.
Yeah. I'm at ease.
You're at ease, you look relaxed, ease. Bob, that's good, I'm pleased to see
I'm
that.
I'm just very curious of all the things that
I know, yeah.
That interests me.
We're turning.
Okay. Yeah, we'll spend a bit of time on this and when you're ready, go.
One more question. What is that recorded on? Is it a tape or a disc?
It's a disc.
A disc.
It's a digital disc.
A DVD.
Similar.
Different.
The Blu-ray.
Oh, the latest.
Okay, so Bob, I want to start by asking you some questions about where we are here in Tokoroa. Can you describe for us Tokoroa? What kind of place is it?
Tokoroa is a mill town. I came here when they were running one paper mill, only one, and they were building number two and number three. And that took about a year and a half. And number one was the only one that was producing paper. That one is sold back to China. And that was the beginning of the Tokoroa. And at the back of us here was all grass. And Balmoral didn't exist. It was all grass. And that was the beginning of the Tokoroa. But then it started to build up more people in the mill, more mills, and everything grown. Until they had about, I believe, 3,500 people employed there. So there was a lot of shortage on houses and flats. Everybody was building flats and houses and was really populated.
So Tokoroa is like a timber town. It's a town built on trees, isn't
mainly
it?
Mainly at that time, yes.
One more time, Bob?
Mostly in that time was the mill. The mill was the main employer. But when the things went, they closing down mills because of shortage of orders, I think, they have employed less people and they sold their houses, the mill houses, to the public. And now there's a lot of mill houses empty and There's two kinds of houses in Tokoda, the private built houses and the mill houses that have been built by the mill.
How many, what percentage of the population here in Tokoroa is related to or working in the timber industry?
I guess now very little. There's a lot more other industries in Tokoroa that have taken employment.
Well, what do you like most about Tokoroa, Bob?
The place.
What do you mean?
The extreme heat, the extreme cold, and quiet, as you see, or as you hear. You don't have many cars around. We are very private. We've got a nice section. I like this place. I wouldn't like to leave this place. This place is our final home.
Excellent. I'll just get you, that was very good, Bob. I'm just going to get you to give me the front of that again. The reason that is because I want you to include the subject and the answer. So I want you to say Tokoroa. So if you can say something like, I like Tokoroa because it's quiet.
Uh-huh.
You know what I mean? You can see what I'm doing, can't you?
Yeah.
So that it makes sense when we edit it.
Yeah. That the whole sentence is a whole sentence.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Okay, Bob, where you go?
Well, I like Tokoroa because it's a very quiet where we live, and it's very central in the country. It's on the main highway. We got swimming pool, hospital, we got everything we need. We don't need any more. And the prices are cheap.
Do you mean the property prices?
Everything.
Okay.
The countdown, the food stop, they're all cheaper here. And no parking meters.
That's good. That's a definite advantage. How long did you say you've lived in Tokoroa, Bob?
I lived in Tokoroa about 37 years. I came here in 1963.
Wow. You guys are real long-time residents.
Yes.
Okay, before we start talking about these annoying trees, Bob, I'll just let you guys know that the way to do it, you're doing really well, and the way to do it is to keep our answers nice and concise. So we want to keep one idea to each answer and keep it nice and short and punchy.
Yeah.
Okay?
That every sentence made sense.
Yeah, exactly. You're doing great, Bob. Okay. So, Bob, when did these trees, the ones out here, when did they first become a problem?
Well, there's quite a history about trees in this place. When we came here, the attraction was trees. Because the whole street was full of trees, like Cambridge. And then, but they were, they lose their leaves in the winter. And we had no problem with the sun. We didn't even realize the trees across the road were there. We didn't have any problem. We had the sun in the winter. But then, suddenly one night, we woke up with a lot of rush of water. And the tree just across our section broke a main water line, and they had to come and stop the water, take the tree out, repair everything temporary, and later they took all those trees out of the street and put a new main line, a plastic main line. There was a fiber line before.
So and the roots of the tree had broken the water line?
That's right, yes. Of the street trees. They were on the beside the footpath. And then slowly we start to be deprived of the sun because the trees across the road, this is about 15, 17 years ago, they started to grow up and stop the sun from shining to us because of their height. And from then on, we went to see them and talked about them, and they were not going to do anything about it.
When you say them, who do you mean?
The Henrys.
The neighbours?
The neighbours, yeah. The neighbours.
Now, so the trees were fine at first, then at a certain point they reached a height where they started to block the tree,
yes.
Block the sun.
Yes.
And this was about 15 years ago.
Yes. But in the meantime, there were more trees across the road, more on the next door neighbor of them. And at one stage, I don't remember what I did, but I put an article in the paper or something about the trees. And they put a note, a board beside the tree, save this tree from the madmen. And I took a photo of that, but I lost the photo. I don't know where the photo is. Maybe my friend can find the photo back, but that was so. And so
there was a sign by the tree?
Yes.
And someone
at the foot of the tree. And a few months later, that tree blown over.
Who put the sign by the tree?
We don't know. It could be the neighbor or one of the two neighbors.
And
they were friends.
What do you think they were trying to say with that sign?
That they want to keep their trees.
But what did they mean by
madman?
From you?
Yeah.
But why did they... So you'd been to talk to them about getting the tree trimmed?
Yes.
Or removed?
Trimmed.
And why do you think they reacted so harshly to you suggesting the tree should be trimmed?
No, I was concerned about the sunlight in the winter. I'm not interested in the trees. The trees are the cause of the trouble. And I've got no quarrel with them or with the trees. But every time I mention that I am out of sunshine in the middle of the winter, they ask, or the county asked me, how come you haven't got sunshine? I say, because of the trees. Then they pass me, they tell me, oh, you go and see them, and that is your business, nothing to do with us.
You mean the council?
The council. Nobody wants to do anything about it because we don't have any protection for the direct sunlight. There's no law that support anyone to get direct sunlight.
Bob, what did you think when you saw the sign that said, save this tree from the madman?
What do I think? I think that they are not all there. They can't make sense. They're very selfish. They're thinking about themselves. What they want, they don't care about me. And we are all... My wife has had depression, very bad depression. She had asthma. And we got a letter from the doctor that we should get some sunshine in our place because our place becomes very cold and moist and depressing. When the sun shines, that means there's a blue sky. A blue sky don't give any light. So our place is darker with the sun than without it. The sun shines over our place, all the way in the back. Everybody gets the sun, but we don't. And we don't even get light from the clouds, because there's no clouds. This place is very cold and somber. And we get depressed. Yet this place has been built to meet the sun in every way, well built.
You mean it's pointing in the direction of the sun?
Well, it's built according to the benefit of the sun. Both bedrooms are facing the sun, our lounge facing the sun. The other side of the house doesn't matter. This is where the night sun comes.
Okay, so it's mainly in the winter the problem with the sun, because
the
sun's lower in the sky.
At least 4 months of the year.
4 months of the year. Can I get you to say that one more time, Bob?
Yeah, we want to have one sentence on its own. We do get the sun the whole year except 4 months in the winter. The sun doesn't come above the trees, so therefore the whole house is in the dark.
And it's freezing.
And yes, the ice is on the window. Well, you can't keep your hand on the garage door because it's too hot.
So the garage receiving the sun is nice and warm?
Because it's away from the trees.
But the house is like a fridge?
Yes. It's freezing. There's ice on the window. Well, the garage is hot.
And before the trees grew to that height, you used to have a nice warm house all the way?
We had no problem.
Can I get you to put that in one sentence for me, Bob? Before the trees?
Yeah. When we first moved in here, there were a lot of trees in the street, but they didn't deprive us from the sun because they lost their leaves in the winter. So the sun was coming through the branches, no problem. But as we were here longer, those trees across the road grew that high that the sun couldn't go above it anymore, and the higher they get, the longer our winter.
Okay, great. What kind of trees are they, Bob? How tall are they? How old are they?
Well, they must be at least over 30 years, and they are as high as twice the lamppost height. I think the lamppost is 15 meters, therefore they must be 30 meters high, approximately. I don't know.
What kind of trees are they?
Evergreen. Pine.
Right, so these pines have grown up, and because they're evergreen, they're blocking the sun right through the winter, and they're very tall.
Maybe you can have a look at those trees. They are growing in cluster, about 6-7 main trunks all at once, and they've tried to get to the sun sooner. And there's one tree dying because it can't keep up to the height.
Has anyone done any kind of maintenance on the trees? Has anyone done any kind of maintenance on the trees?
No, nothing at all. You at all need somebody come and have a look at those trees. And they will see what the trees are like. They're not being maintained. They've been too mean to do anything to those trees. There's no care at all. They just grow.
You think the neighbours are too cheap to pay for their maintenance?
They're just too mean. They don't do anything to them. They need to be trimmed and looked after, and like they do in parks.
What was your neighbour's reaction when you first raised the issue of the trees?
I was filming the trees, and he came to me. He said, "Don't think you can do something about it, because I'm not going to trim those trees. That they evaluate our property. You can light a fire or move."
What did he mean by light a fire or move?
That's what he told me. For us to light a fire if it's too cold, or move, go to another place.
What did you think of that reaction?
Very, very poor, very selfish. I think he should move into a forest, and us living in the town. This place was bare to start with.
Seems a bit inconsiderate of him.
Very inconsiderate.
Okay.
Stop.
Mm-hmm. Yes, Bob, I was going to say, could you just do your eye? You've got a tissue there. Just
You can feel it. Can feel it. You can see it. That's why I got the tissue. I might not explain myself like a Kiwi.
No, you're doing very well, Bob.
But I'm coming through.
You're making complete sense, Bob. That's very good. Don't you worry about that.
You're as Kiwi as anybody, Bob. Don't worry about that.
And maybe more Kiwi than some.
Yes.
Now, Bob, you like filming and what have you. So tell me exactly, why were you filming the trees?
To have some evidence. I filmed the trees to have evidence of what is going on, and hoping to keep those films year by year, so to see the progress of the trees.
So you wanted to document how this problem was becoming worse?
I can show you on the video, on the computer, all the photos that I made of it.
Photos, not video footage.
Yeah. And I've also had communication with a pilot that flies some planes in town. We got an airport here, and there's some amateur planes. And I asked them if they could, in the winter morning, to fly over here and take photos of the shade that the trees are creating here from above.
And did he do that?
we're still in the making. That'll happen this year.
Okay. I just want to step back a little bit, Bob, to the sign that you mentioned that the neighbours put out. I want you to put into one sentence for me the idea that you complained about the trees, then after you'd made the complaint, the neighbours put out the sign, and tell me exactly what the sign said. Well, I want all that in one sentence if you can, Bob.
I don't know how to think of it, how to do that. The neighbors were talking to one another, and we were concerned about the trees, and I asked if they could remove or trim the tree. It was a tree that goes yellow a certain time of the year, and is very hard on asthma patients, and I would like that to be trimmed. So they laughed at me, and they were not going to do that. So they're quite happy with those trees. And next thing I found a notice against the tree that said, save this tree from the madman.
Describe the sign. Is it a big sign? Is it painted? Is it...
It's about
cardboard.
A cardboard sign done very primitively. About, 2 feet square, and I think was about whitewash or something. But about 2 months later, the wind blew the tree over, and he had no more tree there. And I got a photo of that now. I got a photo of the root of that tree laying down on their section.
So the very tree that they thought had to be saved from you was pushed over by nature.
By the wind.
Who do you think that sign was addressed to? Was it addressed to you, or was it saying to everyone else?
Well, I guess the idea was against me because nobody else was worried about that tree.
Okay, great. Thanks, Bob. We'll go back to where we were now. So you took some photos of the tree, the trees you were worried about, and Mr. Henry didn't like that, obviously.
Well, it wasn't this section, it was not this tree. That tree that blown over was the next door section.
Oh, sure. But when you did take photos of Mr. Henry's tree, and he said to you, light a fire or move, he didn't like the fact that you were taking photos of his trees.
No, that had nothing to do with one another.
Sure, but I'm talking now about the moment when Mr. Henry said, light a fire or move. Was the same moment that you were taking the photos of the trees to...
No. Different times.
Okay.
Maybe different even years.
Have you had any other communication with John about the trees directly since the moment when you had that?
The last communication I had with Henry was maybe, 3-4 years ago? And we don't talk to one another. We know where we stand. He knows that I don't like his trees. He knows that the situation is not going to move. He told me that I should save my money because I would get nowhere. It doesn't matter what money I spent, he will not move.
What do you think of his attitude?
Very arrogant.
Can you say that for me? I think his attitude is...
His attitude is very arrogant towards us.
Okay, now, Margaret, tell me about the impact that the cold weather caused by the lack of sunlight is having on your health.
It's only in the winter time when the sun is not coming through.
And what does the cold mean? Is it an asthma?
Asthma, yeah. Lung infection.
And because the sun's not shining on the house, there's more moisture in the house, and the moisture is not good for the lungs.
No, for your lungs.
Okay, can I get you just to say, can you make that connection for me, Margaret, between the lack of sunlight and the moisture?
Can I tell her?
Yeah, that'd be great.
2 seconds, Bob, we'll just move the camera across.
Je moet proberen het één zin te zeggen, dat doordat de zon hier niet schijnt, krijg ik het beroerd en dan krijg ik astma-attack door de kou en it's too cold and too miserable.
Nee,
Because of this no sun that makes the place cold and moist.
Yeah.
You. Can you ask the question, making it easier?
So tell me, Margaret, how the lack of sun affects your lungs.
Well, it's very dampy, watery, and cold very early in the morning. It makes me sick.
Got it. Thank you, Margaret. That makes it nice and clear for me.
Can I tell you something I'd like to say?
Of course you can, Bob.
Because of our situation, no sun, we have taken advice from the Henrys to light a fire. That fire is in the form of a second heat pump in our bedroom, so when we wake up, we can warm our bedroom, dry our bedroom, so that she doesn't feel that cold, because it takes too long to warm up this place.
Okay, so the main measure you've taken because of the lack of sun has been to install another heat pump.
In the bedroom. You can't put a fire in the bedroom, but you can put a heat pump in the bedroom. You can do that. You can't do that with any other fire.
Is the heat pump working? Is it making a difference?
It's nice and dry, nice and warm.
Yes, it makes the place warm and cozy, and you can't hear it. It's very quiet.
But obviously this has not solved the problem.
It solved the problem for the morning. We can stay in bed a little longer, have a cup of tea in bed, instead of coming in this cold, because the whole house is cold. But now we got one place where it's nice and cozy.
Would you say that you've turned your bedroom into a kind of refuge from the cold?
Yes.
And that's limiting your movement around the house,
of
right?
Of course. Like after lunch, she wants to go for a rest because she doesn't sleep all night because of her pain. And then we... I lost my line. Oh, yes. Then she goes lunchtime, after lunch, she goes for a rest in her bed. But when it's cold and miserable, we have the heat pump in the bedroom warm for her to rest and feel in a cozy place, the bedroom. Small, cozy.
Now, this must be costing you a lot of extra money and power.
No. That heat pump is only a 1,000 watt ampere. Well, this one is over 2,000 watt ampere. And it takes a lot of heat out of the heat pump to heat up this lounge. So by not using this one in the morning and have it nice and cozy in the bedroom, we cozy in some place. It's nice to have a place to be nice.
But it's very difficult to heat the whole house without the
sun. We got a heater, a coal heater, but they don't sell the coal anymore. Ray Cabo used to be a very good coal that didn't smoke, and that's what this meant. You put one bucket of coal for the whole day in that Dutch heater. It's a Yasma.
Okay, Bob, what I want you to do is the point I want you to make for me, if I'm not mistaken, is that the heat pump is making a difference, but the heat pump does not solve the problem in the whole house.
Oh, no.
I need you to make that clear for me.
Well, in Europe, you have central heating, and you've got radiators in every room, and you turn the radiator off which room you don't use. So you only have the room you use heated. But in New Zealand, you haven't got a central heating, so you heat up the room that you live in, which is this lounge. And the lounge is heated with that heat pump quite comfortably. And we have it on from the afternoon right up to nighttime, which saves a lot of money. We don't have to have the house heated all day because we are active. But the bedroom, we wake up and we like to have it. All we have to do is push on the remote and the bedroom is nice and cozy within about a half an hour.
Okay, but how would having more sunlight reaching the house improve things here?
By the sun is very hot. That is a very nice thing about New Zealand. in Holland, when the sun shines in the winter, you see it, but you don't feel anything. It's cold. It's a cold light. Well, in New Zealand, it's beautiful. This, the middle of the winter, the first sun that comes across, you feel the heat on your face. It warms up. But we don't get that because of those trees.
And obviously the sun makes you feel good. You need to have sun.
That is the light, dry and warm.
Tell me about how the lack of sun is affecting. You said before there was it makes you depressed. How is it making you feel? How are you unhappy?
Because it's dark. There's no light. Those trees are like a black wall in front of the window. And there's no light. Like with video, you've got to have light source. There's no light source into the bedroom, into the lounge, because the trees are creating a dark wall. And above the trees, if it's a sunny day, the sky is blue. It doesn't give any light. So the room here is far darker on a sunny light, on a sunny day, than on a cloudy day.
Do you feel this is reducing your quality of life?
Oh, sure. It makes... You know how people get depressed when it rains too long? When there's no sun, you get depressed. The sun is life. The sun gives you life and happiness. People go to the sun. Everybody goes to the sun. We depend on the sun.
We worship the sun.
You are sure.
And you guys want more light and happiness in your life.
That's right. We just want what everybody else has. Why shouldn't we get what everybody else has? Free.
The Maori people call it the Tūranga Waiwai, which means place in the sun, place to stand.
Yeah.
Okay. Do you think that the lack of sun is going to impact on the value of this property, Bob?
Well, he said that the trimming his trees will devaluate his property, and cutting them down will make the trees look funny. So he's decided not to do anything. But I can move. If I move, who's going to buy this section? Who's going to buy a section where he doesn't get any sun? I wasn't fortunate to know that in the past. I didn't know in the past that these trees are going like this. I wouldn't have bought this place.
But he will probably say, I think John Henry likes to say, when you moved in, the trees were there, so you should have known the trees were going to grow and that they would be a problem one day.
There's trees everywhere, but don't everybody let them grow. Trees are depending on the people, how they let them grow. You're supposed to look. The law says that you got to trim your trees if they annoy your neighbours.
So the real problem here is that the neighbour's not maintaining the trees.
That's right.
Can I get you to put that in one idea for me?
By not looking after his trees, by trimming the trees to respect his neighbours, he's offending the neighbours. He doesn't care about anybody else.
Bob, what would you like to see happen to those trees?
I don't care what they do to those trees. Those trees are not my concern. I like to have the sun, and whatever it takes. If we complain to the county that we are in smoke, it smells, it takes it on our throat, they come and have a look where the smoke comes from. They're going to visit the people, they're going to tell them to reduce the smoke, whatever. If we complain about noise, they come over, they have a look, or they're going to find out where the sound comes from, and they're going to tell them off, and they might even take their equipment off. We complain about the sun, and they say, how come you don't get the sun? Oh, because of those trees. Well, go and talk to them. It's not our business. because we're not entitled to have the sun. There's no law. So we are left on our own. And nobody can help us. And that even a solicitor charges us $250 to listen to us, and he may help me or not. We don't know. That could cost thousands of dollars to try to get him to trim his trees. He should pay for having those trees. He should ask for a permit. He is the one that offends. He's the culprit.
So you're feeling a little bit powerless.
We got no power. Nobody can help. We got the human rights, a different solicitor. They don't want to even take the case because they know they can't do anything. There's no law to give us the sun. We should be entitled to the sun.
Gotcha. So you've talked to... I want to talk about some of the things you've done to raise this issue. Yep, take your time. Go for it, Bob. The next question I have is just I want to go through what we've done to try and solve the problem, Bob, because you did a number of things. You wrote a letter to the paper some time ago. You talked to a solicitor, and you obviously talked to the Human Rights Commission.
No solicitor in town will take us, will do, help us. They just don't want to do anything because they know they can't do anything.
Okay. Okay, come back on to... So, Bob, when you tell me quickly what happened when you first approached the solicitor and you found this out. What did they say?
We went to one solicitor about, 12 years ago or so. At least 12 to 15 years ago. And he wrote a letter to Henry. And Henry didn't take any notice. And we paid 80-something dollars. We also... got a small claim court case against him. We were asked, I got all the papers there that you can show, that we have to, that cost me $30 to have this court case. We got to the office with the mediator, Henry and I, on three different desk. I was explaining what I needed. I wanted the sun, and that wasn't taking much time to explain. He had three pages of all kinds of excuses why he wanted to keep his trees. The mediator said, well, I'll join this case, and I want to see those trees for myself. And then a fortnight later or so, I got a letter that the case has been struck off.
Why?
I got that on a paper. I can show you that paper later. I can't, unless I read it to you, but I think you can put those papers on.
So the mediator decided for himself, he must have looked at the problem and thought there was no problem.
I can show you, I got all these papers there for you to see.
Okay. Just before when you guys did this, when you were saying you don't understand, can I get you to do that again? Because we were on a tight shot and now we've come out to a wide, and it was both of you at the same time, because I said to you, why did he say that? And you both went. Can I get you just to do that for
why
me again?
Why did he say what?
I was saying to you before, I was asking you why the mediator had called off the...
Oh, yes.
And,
yes,
and you said, we don't know why. And what I want you to do is I want you to do that for me again.
Yeah, yeah, okay.
Because now I'm on a wide shot, I can see it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So,
three, two, one.
When we got this letter that the case has been struck off, there's no explanation. I don't know. It's that they haven't got any grounds to carry this thing on.
Okay, good. Thanks. Well, can I just get you both to go without speaking, both you, Bob and Margaret, just to go like that for me? Like a reaction.
Yeah,
this was your reaction, you know?
Yeah.
One, two, three. Perfect. Thanks. Okay. So that's the mediator. What happened when you went to the Human Rights Commission? How did you get on to that?
I didn't go. I wrote.
You wrote to the Human Rights Commission?
Yeah, I wrote to the Human Rights, asking what they could do, and I got a reply that they can't do anything.
What did you think of that?
Well, it all looks as if our case is not a criminal case. And because it's not criminal, they don't deal with it. I even been to the police and explained to the police, what can I do? And the constable, community constable, and she couldn't help. So I've been trying everything, even pay go. Now I'm thinking of getting to, what do you call that program after 6 o'clock? Close up. I was going to write to close up, explain my case, and ask if I can have an interview with them to see what the public is going to react, because there must be lots of people that are in the same situation. There are at least 15 or more in Dogoroa.
Do you think Mark Sainsbury might be able to help?
Not that they help, but they will wake up a lot of people. Because when people know that they're not by themselves, that there are more people, they might do something by voting, by doing something. People have to be aware that they have no protection for the sun. You can buy a section somewhere next to somebody, and before you know, they keep growing trees and you're in the shade and there's nothing you can do. It's not right.
Gotcha. Okay, great. We're doing really well here, Bob and Margaret. We're trucking through it.
I've
only got
so.
A few more questions and then we'll have a bit of a move around.
Yeah.
Lee, I'm just letting you know there's a low level warm up that's been going. It's not.
Okay. Just want to get a buzz track at the end.
Yeah, it's just.
Do you want it? Is it there now?
Yep.
Do you want a bit of buzz now?
We'll do it now if you can.
30 seconds?
Yep.
Okay, guys, just going to have 30 seconds of quiet, no talking, no moving. Just going to record some audio, okay, from now. Okay, now, we've seen the submission that Mr. Henry made to the Disputes Tribunal, Bob, and he raised a number of points. So what I'll do is I want to get you a right of reply to what Mr. Henry said.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll tell you some of the things he's been saying, and I want you guys to tell me what you think about what he's saying, okay?
Yeah.
Before we do that, you wanted to claim $1,000 with the Disputes Tribunal, is that right?
That's what I did.
Uh-huh. And why $1,000?
Because I had to say something, otherwise they couldn't take my case. They had to have an amount that I claimed for. It's a small claim court, and I had to claim for something. I wasn't claiming, I was only wanting the sum. But that doesn't work with a small case court. They had to have a claim, how much I wanted. So
okay.
I had to put it on to, I don't know, $2,000 to get that for compensation from not having the sun, but that's not what I wanted.
Okay, can you say for me that you put the dollar amount in there for me? If you say, I made a claim for...
I'm not sure. I got it on the paper.
Okay, but it was at least $1,000 or more?
More. Yeah,
okay.
$1,000 or more, yes.
Can you say, I made a claim for more than $1,000 because...
I made a claim for more than $1,000.
All right, let's get on to this, what the neighbour said. The neighbour says the trees are an integral part of his family life. What's your response to that?
Can't be true.
Why?
Because he didn't plant them. And anyhow, that is not important compared with the depriving us of the sun. The law is he shouldn't stop the sunshine on somebody else's. That is not his right. He hasn't got a permit, If he wanted those trees, he should ask for a permit to be above the law. They're not historical trees. There's nothing in those trees. It's just rubbish. Just ordinary pine trees.
What about the sentimental value, though, that they have for him?
That is laziness and meanness. That is his sentimental value. He said his property will devaluate if the trees are trimmed. That is his feeling.
What do you think about the neighbour's suggestion that the trees are important because they provide him with privacy?
That is hooey, because we can look at his TV from under the trees, out of our window.
How do you see his TV?
Because the trees are bare underneath, and we can look into his house under the trees.
So the idea...
We can see them... going up the stairs. They live upstairs. There's a two-story house. We can look under the trees. The trees are not covering him. They're too high. Those trees are too tall to be giving privacy.
Okay, Bob, can I get you to say, the neighbour says the trees give him privacy, but we can see, and then explain how you can see everything.
No, how did the question come?
I want you to say as a statement... The neighbour says that the trees give him... The neighbour says that the trees give him privacy, but actually we can see everything. It's the same thing you just did, but it's just with the putting the subject first. The neighbour says, okay, when you're ready.
The neighbours have those trees for privacy, but the trees are that tall that we can see the whole house, everything under the trees. We can even watch their TV from our lounge.
Excellent, thanks.
You can see the
TV.
May
I change disc appeals?
Sure.
We just changed the disc.
Oh, yeah. How much?
42 minutes.
That was 42 minutes, Bob.
How much? Keep the bag.
23.
Oh.
It won't be long before you have a terabyte of storage put to your back.
Yeah, it won't be. You're right. That's the way
is
to do it.
Is it magnetic or...
Let's keep going. Wouldn't it be great not to change disks in an interview?
So
we might be in the middle of something and then... That's the way it's going to go. You're right.
Yes. DVD is red.
Yeah, like cameraman, news camera and stuff. Just with bells and just go nuts.
DVD's red and it's this wide. The blue is this wide.
Oh.
Six times smaller.
Oh. Eventually you want to be able to send the fluid straight through your belt to the network.
Amazing,
for your news camera.
Very good.
I mean, they do that with stills, don't they? They just go straight to the set.
The most advanced I've ever seen in sound was in the... I was a projectionist in Atimuri.
Yes.
And they had the sound film, which is optical.
Optical.
And how coarse it is comparing with today's magnetic tapes film.
Digital.
And they have about they are digital magnetic on seven
tracks
to make that surround sound.
It's getting better all the time.
7. I've seen how the West was run on Cinerama in Oakland.
Did you?
Have you seen any 3D yet? 3D films?
No, I've seen 3D with glasses, but.
You still need the glasses, but it's great.
Avatar is amazing. Oh, it's great. Amazing.
Yeah, I think I will miss out on a lot of new technology.
Every week.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, Bob, the rest of the questions I have before we finish the interview are chiefly about what John Henry said in his, and I want you to respond. So I'll go through all of them. There's about 10 of them, but let's keep the answers nice and short, because I want to keep you guys fresh.
How did you get those questions?
Because they were provided to us by the neighbour. And it's a public, it's the Disputes Tribunal, is a public forum, so we can always access that information.
Oh, so you do have some...
We have some information, just enough, because we need to know both sides in order to be able to ask your questions.
You've got to see both sides, of course.
Okay, so I'll give you hit some of these points. Some of them you may have already touched on, but we just want a quick response to each. You know?
He liked those trees also so his kids can shoot at the birds.
Say that again.
What?
He likes those trees because the kids can shoot at the birds.
With what?
With shanghais. We hear the laughing and going on. The kids are shooting at birds in the trees.
What kind of birds? Native birds? Or
the birds that were in the trees.
The neighbour says the trees are important because they're a home to the native birds.
Yeah, home to shoot at. He is a hunter. He hunts for deer, pigs, and anything that is alive. Now his fridges are full of wild stuff.
Okay. Now, John says that you're exaggerating the problem.
What problem?
The problem of the light on the trees blocking
That's
the light.
That's right. He doesn't accept that the house is fully in the shade in the winter. Now, I've got photos, I've made photos to show how they are in the shade. He doesn't live here. I live here. I know.
He says that he took photos himself at regular half-hour intervals from about 7 a.m. in winter, and he believes that, yeah, it doesn't block the sun at all.
Well, I got proof that he doesn't know. He doesn't... How does he know? He doesn't live here.
Right. He thinks that your eaves are what's blocking the sun, not the trees, the actual eaves of the house.
That's right. In the summer. In the summer, the sun is going over us. And we don't want the sun in the summer. It's too hot. The house is made to meet the sun all year. In the summer, there's no sun coming in here because of the eave, as you call it. But in the winter, the sun is low, and that heat comes inside the house. That's why we got those louvers here. I can show you the three trees that we have cut down to get more sun. We wouldn't do that if we were not keen on having sunshine. There's one big tree cut down here, there's another tree cut down here, and one over there. So we get the sun whenever it's available. But his trees are stopping everything.
He says that there was no problem with the trees until one particular day when you took exception to him. You had you tried to talk to him and he was too busy and he told you he didn't have time, and he thinks that you took exception to that. And only since that time has there been a problem with the trees.
No, the trees are growing. And that was maybe around about 15 years or so ago when we started to notice that the winter morning we didn't have the sun. But that was one window, then that window, then that window. Now it's the whole house.
So this has been going on for 15 years?
More than 50 years. I'd say always 15 years, but maybe already 2 or 3 years ago.
Is it getting worse each year? It must be if
of
the trees
course,
are getting taller.
Because of the height of the trees. It's the height of the trees that concern us. If these trees were low, below the light post, for example, we would have sun maybe at about 9 o'clock. But now we don't get sun at all winter on that side of the house. By the time the sun is there, it's half the day. And before, when that tree fell over, there was another tree there with a twin trunk, and that neighbor took it down. And that gave us 1 hour sooner sun in the morning. Instead of being 11 o'clock, it was half past 11 or so. Because that tree also left. Also a pine tree, last pine tree, was kept together with wire rope.
Okay, Bob, can I get you to say in one sentence the fact that it's been going on for 15 years, and because the trees are growing, it gets worse every year. I just want something about that length, just one sentence that puts that idea in one for me, nice and short.
About 15 years ago, we noticed that those trees are starting to put us in the shade. And every year, the shade was sooner in the autumn and later in the spring. And every year, as the tree grows, the sun is disappearing earlier
in the morning and comes behind the trees later in the later morning.
You must be getting sick of it after 15 years.
You're telling me. Especially when the ice is on the window while the garage is nice and hot. So we can't live in the garage for him.
He seems to think that you guys painted your roof
white.
Yeah, and he says that that reflects a lot of the heat. So
that's right.
What do you think about that? Because he seems to think that if you just painted your roof a different color, this place would be warmer.
About the white roof, it wasn't long ago on TV, it was stated that if all the houses are painted white, it would save a lot of pollution, the reflection of the sun. But we got our roof white for the summer to keep our attic moist and cool. And in the winter, being white, it doesn't emit the heat. It keeps the heat in. If you have a white, that's why a refrigerator is white. If you have it black, it will let all the that's why a stove is black and the fridge is white.
He seems to think that the neighbors are getting a lot of glare off your roof from the sun.
I never heard any problems about the glare.
Okay.
Anyhow, what's wrong with the white roof?
Yeah.
And another thing I like to say.
Yeah.
A white roof doesn't click. When the sun shines, your roof expands and clicks. When a cloud comes in, the roof retracts and clicks. And you hear the clicking every time when the clouds are coming. You don't hear that clicking anymore. Plus, the roof stays cool and doesn't break down. And the paint lasts longer being wet.
Okay. John says that if we interfere with the trees by trimming them, it would affect the smaller trees and it would affect the native birds living in there. What do you say to that?
What happened to the birds in the past, before the trees were that size? Could they survive? Or has he thought about the birds need large trees, then he grows his trees large for the birds? I don't think that makes much sense. So everybody that got no tall trees doesn't love birds.
So what you're saying is you love birds just as much as the next guy?
Of course.
Yeah. Okay.
So we feed the birds. Margaret feed the birds. Our cats like the birds too.
But don't you think that the trees are just a fact of life in a place like Tokoroa though?
Tokoroa has been very populated for the last 40 years. And we can take two examples. Cabrero, I worked in Cabrero 40 years ago, and there was not a tree in whole Cabrero. You go to Cabrero now and you see a lot of trees. But if any tree is in the way of anybody, they complain to the county, they go to bylaw that the trees are being trimmed. That is the law there. Here they don't have this law. And people, when we look at the back here, we see lots of large trees because they just left growing. They don't look after the trees. They don't think about it.
Are you saying that because people love trees so much in Tokoroa, they're forgetting to take care of them?
No. Not because if they love trees, they have trees. But they got to stay within the law not to have the trees shading other neighbors.
Gotcha. John Henry seems to think that you've been involved with a bit of snooping around the neighborhood and spying on other people, and that's why one of the neighbors tinted their windows. What do you say to that?
Never heard of it.
Come out to it too.
I never heard that. But What have I got to see from the neighbors? I've got my time busy here. I don't go to... We got no contact
we
with nobody.
Neighbors.
But where the neighbors were, we had friends there. The Marshall. the marshal lived there, and we were good friends. They came here, we came there. And we know that house very well. But when they have three different occupied, and we sort of interested in that place because that was the house we knew. But that's all. We only interested in what the house is like now because they've done a lot of alteration. We just, I lived in 35 Phillips Street. Sometimes I like to go there and have a look what people live there. And, you know, just the neighborhood's contact. We don't mind. Today, nobody knows nobody. We all look at one another as if we're aliens.
So you're saying there should be a bit more contact between neighbors and people?
We should be able to... In the old days, we say hello to one another. There's no such thing anymore. Everybody looks straight forward as if you're still here.
Do you think people are a little bit too defensive and protective these days?
Well, with all the news you're hearing, you can't trust anybody anymore. There's a sign on the post there, Neighborhood Watch. But nobody knows, watches nobody.
You know, another thing that John says is that we need to keep the trees because they help with global warming.
I got no answer on that one. That's too stupid.
It's a good one, that one.
Stupid. Especially pine trees. If they were trees with leaves, they're helping a lot with the oxygen. But pine trees give very little oxygen.
So as far as you're concerned, Bob, they're not very important trees. They're not very helpful. They're getting in the way. They should go. They should be trimmed.
I am not interested in those trees. I like to see sun. And whatever is the cause that we don't have any sun is for the county to look after. They have to see them. We don't have anything to do with neighbors. And the trees don't interest me. He can grow as many trees as he likes, as long as it doesn't take away my son.
Okay, so what's the one thing you want to see happen? If I could wave my magic wand and fix this problem, what would be the one thing you want to change?
Direct sunlight. I like that. I like that light here. Direct sunlight. That's what I like. At any cost.
Why did you decide to come to Neighbours at All? Because you were desperate and you had no other options?
Repeat that thing.
Why did you decide to come to our show? Because you couldn't?
I haven't. No.
I thought you did.
No. What are you? Neighbours at War?
Yeah.
I didn't know about that.
You came to Fair Go, did you?
No, I went to Fair Go. Fair Go didn't take me. And then somebody from your crowd have heard of me with the trees and asked me if I'd like to go into the Neighbours at War. That's how I got to the people.
Okay. Do you think that, because you're from Holland originally, Bob.
Belgium,
originally. Mm-hmm. Oh, I'm sorry. I thought there was a mention of Belgium, but I got mixed up with the trips to Holland.
I could
not
only speak French.
Because Margaret is from Holland.
Yeah.
Okay. Sorry, Margaret. Sorry, Bob. Do you think there's an element of racism here or xenophobia from the neighbours?
I always felt that there are certain Kiwis that don't like foreigners, and he is one of them. I don't think he likes foreigners, whatever.
And that's part of the problem here?
Maybe that's also a feeling, but it doesn't worry me. I'm used to it.
Bob, just to finish, tell me about your, very quickly, because we're running out of time, tell me about your videography and your work with cameras and stuff.
When I came to New Zealand, I was already doing filming on movie films. And I've done movie films for quite a while. I've got lots of movie films. And then came video. And I was the second one in Tokoroa with a movie camera, a Beta. And that was just a camera and a sound on a case with reel-to-reel tape and only 20 minutes recording. That was my first camera in Tokoroa. And I got lots of contact through that with teaching swimming, with opera. I did a lot of help with that sort of thing, and interesting. Then the next camera was the AV, and then high 8. And I go on with filming. I still got a lot of movie film, which I can transfer onto digital, into DVD, and use a reel and put it onto DVD so they can enjoy their film with sound and music, whatever they like, and titling. And that's my hobby. I like doing this.
Bob, do you think that because you're a man who likes films and understands films and knows how to work cameras, that you're more aware about light than normal people?
Oh, yes, sure.
Is this a factor here?
No, I know light is important. We depend on light. And every house should have a lot of light. Light is part of life.
Okay, do you think that your awareness of that is enhanced by the fact that you work with light and cameras and shooting and stuff? You know what I mean? There's a connection here. You're more aware of it than most people.
Anybody that knows us knows that we have our curtains mostly closed because we're not worried about the light in the lounge. For watching TV, you don't want light. We only got that one light here. But light destroys your furniture. If it wasn't for the covering, this wouldn't be like this anymore. All our furniture will go pale with sunlight. So we have everything covered for the furniture, but it's, even so, it's cozy. We keep it cozy.
Okay.
But we can open the curtains when we want to.
Tell me about this is my last question, guys. Tell me about the van that you were showing me before, Bob. What is it exactly and what do you use it for?
The van. To see New Zealand. We've been to the top of the South Island and the end of the North Island. The letterbox on the far north and the post which say which way to go to different countries on the other end. And we've traveled. We've been away to the South Island with that camper for 3 months. And we didn't stop in any park or anywhere. Always stopped on parking spaces, churches and so on. We haven't spent a cent on accommodation. We were totally in the van the 3 months.
Okay. Can I get you to say for me, because I need you to say we have a camper van that we travel in. Can I get you just to put that into one sentence? Just that bit.
What do you want?
I want you to say, we have a camper van and we travel around New Zealand in it.
50 years ago, we bought this camper van because we wanted to see the country at our ease. And we didn't have a business anymore. We had no commitment. And we could go around, see the country before it's too late. And the camper van gave us all our accommodation, everything. We were free as a bird, going where we wanted to be. And we have seen a lot of the country with that camper van.
And you also have a lot of camera equipment and video editing equipment in there. Now tell me about that.
Yeah, the camper van is equipped for doing video anywhere, anytime, doing copies from color slides, taking movie film onto video, onto DVD, anything that you can imagine we can do in the camper van. We got the power, we can sleep, we can live. That was our mobile home.
And why are you making videos, editing videos while you're on the road on holiday?
We didn't do any video of weddings or funerals or anything, but we did from schools. I've got a newspaper piece from South Africa where we did video too, and we were in the newspaper that we were a good representative for South Africa and New Zealand. That was still in the apartheid time, and we are on the front page of the Echo in the R places called the air. And we did video from schools, hospitals, and everything. We just took a documentary of South Africa, and we got to see it on V8.
Okay, just give me an idea of what you have, the kind of equipment you have in the camper van for filming and editing. I mean, how many cameras, how many computers, what's in there? Describe it for me.
In the camper van, we got two cameras. If one breaks down, or if we want to film two at the time, at the same time. And we got the, computer. I'm lost.
Editing software on the computer?
Yeah, but I want to call the computer.
The Apple Mac?
Apple Mac. Computer.
Just start again.
Just say that we have the Apple Mac computer.
We have Apple Mac computer.
Sorry, Bob. Off you go.
We got the Apple Mac computers, two of them, so we can do editing on,
Final Cut?
Final Cut, yes. And I love that work. It's my hobby. And I make good movies out of whatever I pick up, and got all that in the camper van.
Excellent, thanks, Bob. Okay, now that's the end of the interview. But what I want to do before we leave here is we're just going to pick up a few shots that we'll use for the editing purposes, Bob, to the cutaways, so we can splice together your interview. So I want you guys just to stay still and relax for a moment, and you don't need to speak; just need to relax. And
what are you going to call it? Call it correct.
No, he's gonna get some shots that I'll use for editing purposes later. So they're just there's no talking. It's just sitting and relaxing. I'm just looking for my usual crash zooms. Yeah, usual scenario.
You might get your own TV show out of this, Bob.
Both you guys just looking at me without speaking. That's good. I just want the head turns down full on each. Okay, Margaret, if you could just look at me for a little while, and when I say, I'll just get you to just to turn your head towards Bob as though Bob's just said something. So just turning to the side and listening to Bob. Great, and now turning back to look at me. Great, and one more time. Cool, and just leaning back into, that's it. Wonderful. I'm happy with that, Paul. And same for you, Bob, if you're looking at me, and then Margaret should say something, and just turning to listen to Margaret. Okay, and just turning back to me, Bob. And one more time, Margaret said hello, you're turning to face her. One more time, Bob. And back to me. Jolly good, thank you. Hero shots, all good? Oh, we'll do some smiling ones, eh?
Yeah. Yeah, I think it's a bit sunlight. I was going to say, do you want them to get up to take you to show you something?
Mm-hmm. We'll do that. that.
Because it's going to be easier for Bob to do that.
It'll just be Bob. Yeah. I only need Bob to do that.
So, do you want to do that from this position? Come, I'll show you.
Yes, I do. Yes, I do. That's exactly what
and,
I've got.
And maybe once we've done that, we can do a shot with the curtain here drawn open with lots of sunlight in their room. So, as an alternative wide from over there for the interview?
Yeah, sure.
Just to try and... So, is that in the work? Should we do this getting up first?
Yeah, Bob, what we do now is, you know how I said that we're going to go outside and Paul will have the camera on his shoulder and we'll actually go across the road, we'll go and look at these trees and you can say, look at these trees, see how tall they are and you can explain to us the problem. That will be cut into our interview, but that's all going to happen outside. So
they know what we're talking about.
Exactly. So what I want to do now is I actually want you to lead us outside on camera. So I want you to say, you can address me and you can say something like, come outside and I'll show you the problem. Or come outside.
Margaret, you don't have to get up.
You can just stay still, Margaret, you're fine.
Because all we need is for him to rise out of the chair a little.
So you're going to speak to me and
you're going to say... Can you keep me in focus?
Yeah, he's got all that covered, don't worry about that.
Okay, so we're recording.
So he's going to say, I want you to say to me, put it in your own words, Bob, but I want you to invite me and all of us to come outside and see these bloody trees.
Yeah.
So put it in your own words. Once you've done that, just stand up and walk across the room.
Yeah.
Okay?
Are you going that way or...
Straight across there, straight towards the kitchen.
The kitchen. Yeah.
Okay, so address me and invite me out there.
And
do you want me to write it for you?
And they just go on and never understand how hard our lives are.
That's what I put down. That you're only by yourself. And the cameraman and the video, the sound.
Yes.
And they got the seat to the right.
Yes.
You're all by yourself doing everything.
Yes.
And that's not easy.
Never is.
No.
That's what I tell my wife and she never believes.
Okay, that's the 26th.
Yeah, you depend. You depend a lot.
Cool.
Do you have a wedding for a video? Oh, we have a video of a wedding. So what we have is
a good word for
a wedding. They don't pose for you.
Yeah.
I got one very good wedding
that
was on VHS. Professional. It has cost $3,000.
Yes.
That's
that's done properly.
When you've had one that's replaced, are they going to replace the other one as well? When do you think they'll do that?
Maybe 3 months.
Is it better now? Do you feel better with the replacement?
Yeah, we're still a lot of pain.
Yeah. Do you think that it's going to be more mobile ultimately?
Can I use that?
Easier to move?
I'll sit on that, thank you.
You just stay there. That's what I'll do. Excuse me.
Oh, we might give that to Lee.
Yeah.
Okay, Bob. You relax, and I'll just get you to sign. This is the consent form. You just write your name and your signature, and I'll put the date in there.
Lee, while he's doing that, would you mind finding some stock?
Yes, indeed.
So in the truck.
It's right.
Beautiful. I'm just flipping this around the corner. If you just put this so it's hidden. If you can, have you got trails of pocket or something? Just be careful, that's all. Maybe just around your back here. I'll just take this. What we'll do, if I can just reach around here. How's that? So it's just out of your way. We just remember that it's there, we won't attach it. Okay?
Three men, they're fully occupied before the filming. And I get to do anything, I'm just by myself, and there's nothing I can do.
It's a camera.
Just take them.
It's a camera. I'm sorry, I didn't get you to sign a form.
Huh. You hooked up, big boy? Can I throw some tone down?
Do you think, initially when we talked about this, I was thinking that we would be three quarters on Margaret and more straight on to Bob, because Bob would be doing most of the talking.
Have a look.
But
doing the
I'm
job.
Not averse to this. I'm just seeing how we can work it, because Bob can probably turn to face us a bit. Bob is doing the talking, yes.
Yeah.
I think Bob will probably sit back when he's comfortable.
Yeah, but I'm waiting for this to get rid of
it.
Oh,
okay, you can get rid of that.
This part's on. Thanks, Bob.
I left the date for you.
Oh, there's also a location release. Another form as well. This is the same thing, but just for the location release, Bob.
Yeah.
Same again, but it's just to say it's about the house.
Oh, yeah.
Very complicated, isn't it? Lots of wires and cables and
it stays name underneath the corner of premise.
Oh, that's fine. Just that's
no name.
No, that's fine, yeah. Just the date and the signature is fine. Thanks.
The address?
Yeah, and write the address 15 Common Street would be great, thank you.
Sometimes my eyes are watery and sometimes they're okay.
He's crying.
But I don't know why they're watery and why they cry. If it has to do with the mood, my mood. I don't. That must be quite a fisheye. Or is it just very wide angle?
It's a very wide lens, indeed it is.
I got a fish eye, but it doesn't make you look better. But it's the way I thought you would have it.
Really? This is what you expected?
Yeah. I watch everything that is happening. When they make Coronation Street, you see a lot of this setup, how they do one part of the pub, or the other part, it's all in parts.
Yeah.
The
Rovers.
I judge a lot of films, why they do it that way, how did they do it that way? I mean, the people are in a hell of a situation, yet there's plenty of room for the camera and the soundman.
Yeah, it's very clever, isn't it?
You know, I'm realistic. I don't go with the fantasy, I just see the real. How's the sound?
Loud and clear.
Well, you've got sound here, and you've got sound there.
I like to double up.
Oh.
You know,
which that one would be the best, I guess?
Depends, it's full, it makes the sound of the room.
Yeah.
On your microphone, if you just whisper, I can hear everything from you breathing it's very close, as omni in here. Yeah.
When we get the Dutch news, we can hear the inhaling of the reporter.
Oh.
Yeah. Very sharp.
Yeah.
But you can't do that away.
No.
The red balancer?
That's what he's doing.
Yeah.
The old white balance.
Yeah.
That's the low-tech part of it. A bit of paper.
Yeah, that's right. In the old days, you had the white balance. Time. The cap was white. You have to white balance before you start.
Yeah.
I got two of those cameras. The old analog cameras. One is mono, the other one is stereo.
How many cameras have you got altogether, Bob, in your collection?
Six.
Wow.
Two at a time.
Yeah.
That is the latest to the worst.
That's the latest and the worst.
Yeah. I can show you the camera I got before. They were really good cameras on the shoulder.
Yeah.
slowly. Well,
if we pulled that case out of there, you could sit on that rolling chair, and it would also encourage a good volume. The distance might encourage good volume. If that works for you.
You mean, where am I going to be?
If you just chuck that in there, that's fine, mate. Perfect.
Before we start communicate, can you give me an idea how your lines are going to be, so that I'm a bit more prepared for the answers?
Yeah, I can. Well, there's plenty of time for you to think about the question before you give your answer, Bob. So I'll just go through it and I'll give you the questions fresh, because you know the story, you know the facts. You're not going to have any trouble telling me the story. The more difficult thing to remember is that in the show itself, when this goes to air, the questions that I ask you won't be included. We edit my questions out. So that means that when I ask you a question, it'd be good if you can wait just for a slight beat before you answer, so that we can edit.
You know
exactly what I'm talking about. And
talk about the yellow lamp. Is it possible to pull the yellow lamp out?
Oh yeah, that's not nice.
Why? What's wrong with the yellow lamp? I like the yellow lamp.
It doesn't look good. That's because it's a
just in light. Terms of the shape of the three heads, it kind of looks a bit.
That's good. That's good period stuff, you know.
Do you want me to do that?
Can I have a look at that?
Yeah, you can just give him a hand.